As always, we ask, the money, what are you going to be using it for, Ian?
We're really using it to expand the factory that you see behind me right here. So what it really comes down to is there's a massive shift in the industry away from building these very expensive, exquisite systems into moving towards what we call proliferated systems. So how are we launching hundreds of satellites into orbit to really supply for constellations, for commercial applications, government applications, and more? And that requires manufacturing satellite platforms at scale. And for us here in what we call Factory One here in Los Angeles at Apex, before this funding round, we were able to produce about 12 satellites per month out of this facility. And now we're able to up that to about 18. We are continuing to scale that manufacturing, though, because the demand is even far higher than that.
Talk to us about that demand. You're providing essential services, basically, to all satellites that need to survive in space. I'm interested, Ian, as to whether that demand glut at the moment is coming from the government, or is it coming more from the private commercial side of things?
It's a great question. It's actually coming from both. So the one that, you know, is very out there and we talk about a lot is things like Golden Dome and a lot of the U.S. defense initiatives that are pushing for getting more and more of these capabilities into space. Space truly is the ultimate high ground. We're in the middle of what we call a new space race right now, where it's the U.S. against our adversaries, and we're not in a position to win unless we increase that manufacturing. So this demand for constellations is very heavily coming from the government side, but we're also seeing it starting to emerge on the commercial side as well. Companies like SpaceX have really pioneered commercial constellations like Starlink and others, and now we're seeing a lot of other companies follow suit. Even just today, right, the new Apple products went for sale, where all of those iPhones are able to connect to satellites, the new Apple Watches connect to satellites, and seeing more and more of those constellation requirements for what we experience every day with consumer electronics, it just continues to grow.
I mean, it's interesting, Ian, that there's been a lot of pressure put on Apple CEO Tim Cook to make more in America. You, on your website, when you go there, you're proudly made in the USA. But how much are you reliant on components coming from abroad? How much are you trying to ensure that you're sort of self-sufficient here?
So we did an assessment as soon as the tariffs came out, and we said, are we impacted at all? And the impact was pretty much zero. And the reason for that is we really are using U.S. components, but it goes a step further than just U.S. components. Almost everything that we're building, we actually vertically integrate and build in-house here in our facility and then our expansion facility right next door. So by bringing all of that in-house, we really control our own destiny, control the supply chain, and are able to ensure that it's not just about building a lot of these satellite platforms, but it's about building a lot of them incredibly quickly.
To control your own destiny, you don't just need the resources in terms of the production side, but you also need the talent, Ian. How easy or hard is that right now?
I have to say, we are in Los Angeles, which I consider to be one of the aerospace capitals of the world, right? Just down the street is companies like SpaceX or Rocket Lab or the Jet Propulsion Lab Laboratory. We have amazing companies around us that we're able to source great talent from. That being said, we always need more people. We are hiring dozens and soon to be hundreds of roles. We are looking to bring on a lot more people. And frankly, there's not that many people with the skill sets that are actually required. So we are very much looking forward to seeing kind of an increased attention towards aerospace and a lot of students studying this in order for them to come eventually join us here at Apex.
Join you, help serve clients that include Anduril, that include NASA. You've talked about how much everyone focuses on the defense and the government side of things, but there is this real spurring coming from private sector. But if you could ask the US government for one thing right now, Ian, because they are focused on your area, what would it be?
I would say it is rethinking how we do acquisition. So traditionally on the government side of things, it's been working the same way for decades, which is the government will say, I need some capability, and then they go out and they pay people to go build a specific product for those capabilities. What we do here at Apex is very different. We take our investor capital, like this $200 million round led by Achal and Tom at Intralagos, we take that capital, and we invest that into actually building products before the government ever says that they need it. And then once the government realizes they need it, we're able to supply it to them in a matter of days or weeks or months instead of having to wait for years. It also costs way less on the taxpayers by us getting ahead of it. The problem is not all of government procurement has caught up to that strategy where they're still putting out requirements asking for people to make things custom and new. So our big push is, if I were to ask one thing of the US government, it's focus on commercially available off-the-shelf parts, actual products like we have here at Apex, instead of reinventing the wheel every time.